Tonight on The Little Picture Show, murder most foul, Madeline Stowe sees red in blink. Wired up, Kevin Costner's epic battle to win the West commences, and May the Force be with you, the return of the Star Wars trilogy. Hello. Having done reasonably well on its theatrical release, the sexy thriller Blink, starring Madeline Stowe and Aidan Quinn, finally arrives on video. My opinion will, I'm afraid, be biased, because I'm a huge fan of both actors, but that aside, I'm sure anyone who enjoys having the pants scared off them won't feel cheated by this well-directed chiller. Madeline plays Emma Brody, a sexy fiddler in a Celtic rock group in Chicago. She's been blind since the age of 8, but after undergoing a revolutionary eye operation, her sight improves with one unfortunate side effect, retroactive vision, a delayed sight mechanism which means she frequently sees events way after they've actually occurred. This makes her a less than credible witness when she spots a suspected murderer in her apartment block and goes to the police.
You were blind completely up until 6 weeks ago?
That's right, yeah.
So your eyes are having a delayed reaction to reality.
I don't know how to explain this. It's something that happens with some people who've had this kind of surgery, but we're a little off track. I came here to tell you that I think something's really gone wrong.
Okay, it's all right. Okay.
Thank you.
The only person who takes our Madeline seriously is handsome, misogynist Detective Aidan Quinn, who believes there's a serial killer on the loose who's preying on the recipients of donor organs, of whom Madeline numbers one. She, meanwhile, has begun to fall for the charms of her handsome protector. But in a well-worn scenario, he's almost as frightened of getting involved with her as he is for her safety.
Listen to me. You want to be raped, strangled, and drowned in a bath of your own blood, huh? If you want to keep your ass alive, you're going to have to help me. You better be strong.
Using visual trickery to illustrate Emma's distorted eyesight, director Michael Apted manages to create a tense, unnerving atmosphere where nothing is what it seems. Quinn and Stowe make a credible and extremely likable leading couple, and let's face it, provide lecturing material for both sexes. It may not be the most inspired of plots, but Blink certainly gets my recommendation as an entertaining, if petrifying, way of spending an evening.
Sons of bitches.
This year we've had Bad Girls. Later in the year we're expecting Gus Van Sant's Only Cowgirls Get the Blues. And then there was The Ballad of Little Joe, a flurry of women's westerns, which might lead you to think us girls are trying to reinvent the wheel. But if that is indeed the case, then we've still got a long way to go yet. This week is the turn of The Ballad of Little Joe, a film which is loosely based on the true experiences of Josephine Monaghan, a bourgeois girl from Buffalo, New York, who's thrown out of her cozy home when her father discovers she's pregnant.
Dear sister, I have lain awake nights picturing you in your wild wanderings with your boy pressed tightly in my arms. I have prayed to a merciful God to keep you safe and unharmed.
Attacked from all sides, she heads for the western frontier, leaving her baby with her sister. Discovering that life on the open road's a bit precarious for a woman, she chops off her hair, buys a pair of pants, and lives the rest of her life as a man. Ah, if only life were that simple, I'd have done it years ago.
I took you in thinking you were such a pathetic boy. I was going to make a man out of you.
You taught me a lot, Percy. You gave me guidance, helped me learn to survive.
But you're a female. And a whore at that, if I understood that letter correctly.
Setting up home in Idaho, Joe works hard and is soon the proud owner of a flock of sheep. And despite the hardship of life on the plain, Joe manages to fall in love with Tin Man Wong, a Chinese railroad man who discovers her secret.
How long do you think it would take him to figure out about me? Took you 3 days.
But that is me.
Well, then what about us? What do you think would happen if they found out about me? Little Joe Monahan turns out to be a woman and she's lovers with an ailing Chinaman?
Unquestionably. Brutally.
Ex-model Susie Amos didn't fool me for a minute, nor would she have fooled those sex-starved rednecks in the frontier land. Who's she trying to kid? Back in the good old days, though, men may have been men, but women were most definitely to be feared. If you wanted a man, you just went out and got him. Or, in the case of the diminutive Jane Powell, seven of them. Seven Brides for Seven Brothers in blushing colour is MGM's matchmaking musical, chock full of classic songs like Bless Your Beautiful Hide. And if it came to a choice between Little Joe's Ballad or Little Jane's Hoedown, I know which side of the fence I'd be on.
The big picture.
Kevin Costner returns to the Wild West this week as he takes over where Kurt Russell's Tombstone left off in this, the latest adaptation of Wyatt Earp's life, called, strangely enough, Wyatt Earp. Much less of a slam-bam action film than its predecessor, this is more of a sprawling epic as we join Wyatt just before the gunfight at the OK Corral, and then get taken back to his days as a nipper. Born into a strict household presided over by the authoritarian Pa Earp, Gene Hackman, Wyatt leads a true all-American boy's life. Marrying his childhood sweetheart, Orilla, things are looking great for him until typhoid comes calling and Orilla dies. Distraught, Wyatt goes off the rails and only old Dad can help.
I gave him $500 bail and I told him I'd defend you at your trial. There's not going to be any trial. Because if they try you, they'll hang you. And if they catch you, they'll hang you. So you get on that horse, Wyatt, and you ride. You keep riding until you get out of Arkansas. And you don't come back here ever.
A hardened man, Wyatt becomes a loner until he ends up as a lawman in Dodge City.
Mr. Clement, your men respect you, and I don't want to do anything to take away from that. I'm sure you've earned it. So you and your boys are welcome in Dodge City as long as you obey the law. But if you don't want to cooperate, I'm going to open you up right now with this shotgun so wide your whole crew's going to see what you had for breakfast.
Joined by his brothers, they vow to clean up the streets, and of course Wyatt meets the other major person in his life, Doc Holliday, played with relish by Dennis Quaid.
You can't get what you want, Wyatt. You can't kill them all. Look, I'm dead anyway. So if you want to go out in a blaze of glory, I'm with you.
The rest, as they say, is history. What Wyatt Earp has in its favour is its widening of the subject matter, giving a much greater insight into the life of the legendary lawman. Its all-star cast equip themselves finely, and Lawrence Kasdan's direction is meticulous and exhilarating. However, at over 3 hours long, it could have benefited considerably by the removal of 40 minutes' excessive padding. That said, it beats Tombstone into a cocked hat. And in our first competition tonight, we've got a rawhide travel bag, granddaddy shirt, and a presentation copy of the Wyatt Earp script for the winner. Shirts and scripts for the runners-up, if you can tell me who played Wyatt Earp in Tombstone. Was it A, Dennis Quaid, B, Kurt Russell, or C, Val Kilmer? Just phone in on 0891 66 5566. Thank God for the Coen brothers, who continue to prove that Hollywood isn't completely bereft of original and inspired filmmakers. Their latest, The Hudsucker Proxy, definitely qualifies for the must-see list, with its quirky story and fabulous cast of Tim Robbins, Jennifer Jason Leigh, and Paul Newman. Robbins plays Norval Barnes, an unwitting pawn in the hands of conniving businessman Newman, the vice president of Hudsucker Industries.
Thank you.
Head honcho, wearing hudsucker, has just plunged to his death, and in the absence of a will, his fat majority shareholding is up for grabs. Determined to convince prospective investors that the company is worthless, Vice Pres Newman promotes Robbins, ex-postroom boy, to chairman, convinced it will only be a matter of weeks before he runs it into the ground.
Now then. You're from the basement, aren't you? And weren't blessed with much education.
Well, I'm a college graduate.
But you did not excel in your studies.
Well, I made Dean's List. Oh. At the Muncie College of Business Administration.
Oh, and your friends, they called you jerk, didn't they? Dope.
Mm-mm.
Dipstick.
Oh.
Lame brain.
Uh-oh.
Schmo. Not even behind your back.
No, as a matter of fact, they voted me most likely to succeed.
You're fired.
Hudsucker Proxy is the Coen brothers' biggest project to date, responsible for indie classics like Raising Arizona, Miller's Crossing, and the much-lauded Barton Fink. The offbeat duo found a surprising ally for this, their latest project, in none other than action giant Joel Silver. So, has Hollywood's premier indie filmmaking double act finally sold out, or is this the perfect marriage of brain and brawn?
How does your partnership actually work? Because I wondered if having Joel Silver around didn't mean that you had less to do, because you're the producer, aren't you?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I mean, you didn't get another director in, but Joel was kind of in there in a production way. Or does it not work as specifically as director and producer?
First of all, yeah, it doesn't. In fact, I mean, what me and Joel do is sort of kind of indeterminate and very sort of fluid. But Joel Silver's function in the movie was, he was really, he was kind of the studio. I mean, he's the one who got the money, half of the money from Warner Brothers. It was a co-production team, Warner's in working title here. And he was somebody we dealt with rather than having to deal with this whole sort of studio bureaucracy, and he was really helpful. He is really like the sort of big old-time Hollywood moguls. He's like a really large personality, but maybe only different in that respect that he really does do what he says he's going to do. I mean, he was really good about that. He really was interested in letting us make the movie we wanted to make.
We don't crawl here at Hudsucker Industries.
Sir, my leg is on fire.
No assumptions. It's early yet. Anything could happen. Just let me know where we stand at the closing bell.
Oh, my God, sir.
Yeah!
He described it as your what he felt was your most commercial film to date. And why do you think he felt that way? Did you feel that it was your most commercial film?
Well, I think he felt when he looked. There were a number of things I think he responded to in the script. I think he thought it was funny. He's very sort of passionate about architecture and design, and it's a very sort of design-oriented movie. So he, I think, responded to that. And I also think that he felt it potentially was a more commercial movie than we'd written in the past.
Don't worry, Mr. Musbringer! I got you! I got you by your pants!
Pants? Mr. Musbringer, I'm going to give you pants a nice double stitch, hey? Here's, make them real strong, and you're going to look real sharp.
No, single stitch is fine.
But the double stitch, she lasts forever.
Why on earth would I want a double stitch? To pad your account. Single stitch is fine. Damn.
It's visually really quite stunning, and I wondered if the reason that you decided to employ sort of, you know, 20-style buildings and 30s and 40-style costumes and 50s sort of imagery.
Yeah.
Was because you wanted that blend of all those things to make it more of a fantasy, to make sure that people were lost in it as not somewhere specific at a specific time.
Yeah, right. Exactly. I mean, supposedly it takes place in New York in the 50s, but it's not, you're right, in terms of the feeling of the look of the movie, it's not tied real specifically to any one time. And we did want it to have more sort of feeling of once upon a time, some sort of indeterminate past, because it is meant to feel sort of like a fairy tale or comic fable.
Take a look at the mug on this guy, the jutting eyebrows, the simian forehead, the idiotic grin. Why, he has a face only a mother could love. On payday.
The movies that we've done in the past have been on much smaller budgets, but, you know, on their own terms, they've most of them been actually quite successful financially. They haven't. That's the funny thing. I mean, you can get into this game where, we haven't made a movie that's made $100 million. But on the other hand, the movies that we've made have, most of them, more than sort of justified the budgets that they've been made for. So they've been money-making propositions. They just aren't in the sort of, they're not in the same kind of league, or in a weird kind of a way, not in the same kind of business as, the Arnold Schwarzenegger movies or
But that's what I wondered. I wondered, having worked with Joel Silver on this and having had a bigger budget, albeit not a huge one, whether you feel that sort of having sucked from that Hollywood cup, that now you feel you have to compete in that arena, which you never felt before,
No. It was, no. It's not as if we're sort of trying to get a seat at that table for, everything that we do in the future. No, we're perfectly happy to. Our ambition is to keep making the movies we want to make, on essentially on their own terms. But if that means that it's unrealistic to make movies on those sorts of budgets, that's perfectly all right.
Or at least we might as well say that.
Yeah, exactly.
Richard Gere must have cottoned on to the fact that characters with a mental or physical disability score highly with the Academy. Take Tom Hanks in Philadelphia, Dustin Hoffman in Rain Man, and even Daniel Day-Lewis in My Left Foot. In Mr. Jones, Gere is a manic depressive, whose highs and lows make him incredibly charming and attractive one minute, and a danger to himself the next. He ends up in hospital, under the tender care of psychiatrist Lena Olin. Gere's charm intrigues her, and it's not long before he's opening her eyes to the workings of his mind and finding his own inner strength in the process.
Shall we dance?
No way.
A couple steps up, everything's different.
I don't want different.
You want to know who I am? Gotta go where I am.
If you don't get down right now, I'm going.
It's all right, you know. Fear is allowed.
Well, it's just that I even get dizzy in high heels. No, it's silly. No, it's just a childhood thing. There's nothing I can do about it.
With flagrant disregard for professional ethics, the two fall in love. Will she throw caution to the wind, or will good sense prevail?
I want you to be well.
Give me some therapy.
You're not a friend of mine. You have no right to talk to me.
Disappointingly predictable, Gere is like a fish out of water in his designer shirts amidst a hospital full of your stereotypical mental patients. And Olin, although sensitive, is a little willowy for the pressures of psychiatry. Unless you have a penchant for Richard Gere and medical weepies, avoid Mr. Jones at all costs. Far more enjoyable is the first offering from the tiny Baltic nation of Estonia that recently gained independence from the former Soviet Union. Darkness in Tallinn describes one evening during the independence celebrations when a Russian mob attempts to steal the nation's $900 million gold reserve upon its return from Paris, where it had been stashed 50 years earlier prior to enemy invasion. The gang employ Toivo, an impoverished electrician, to black out the city, allowing the bickering thieves to strike amidst the chaos. Meanwhile, Toivo's pregnant wife prematurely gives birth as Tallinn is plunged into darkness. She's losing strength, and without power, the baby's incubator cannot work. As Toivo realizes the consequences of his handiwork, it's a race against time to restore the current to save his family and the nation's future prosperity. Darkness in Tallinn is a modest but cracking little thriller. If this is a taster of what's to come from the New Republics, it's certainly an auspicious start. In part two, the new wave of horror with Mariano Baena's Dark Waters, the return of the Dark Knight in Batman Mask of the Phantasm, and they're back. Luke Skywalker and Princess Leia join their other worldly friends in Star Wars. See you then.
Right, what's going on here, lads? Look, I know it's a long way, but what's going to happen if Mrs. Metcalf doesn't get her milk? The kids don't get their cornflakes. Dad doesn't get his porridge. And Mum doesn't get a cup of tea. So come on, lads. Look lively.
Wouldn't breakfast be a disaster if you didn't have fresh milk delivered every morning?
Well, I don't know what you're laughing at. Auntie Ethel's coming to tea. They want two extra.
What's been the highlight of my day? Discovering I got a secret admirer. Or discovering a chocolate drink that's light in calories. Has all the taste of Cadbury's. So what was the highlight of my day? No contest, really.
High in Cadbury's taste, light in calories. Every day should have its highlights.
Delicious Malty Flakes, the Kellogg Special K low-calorie breakfast. Get the taste. Get the shape. Stay special.
But boy, is it gonna get hotter.
New Invisible Ultra from Bodyform has ultra-soft sides so you don't feel it. It's ultra-thin so you don't see it. And because it's ultra reliable, you can do whatever you want.
What mark would you give the condition of your hair?
5?
4?
3? 2.5?
3?
If your hair doesn't feel good, you don't feel good.
3.5.
Together, VO5 Moisture Balance Shampoos and VO5 Conditioners add softness, shine, and manageability. For beautiful hair, VO5 plus VO5 equals 10.
If you're looking for a milkman, all you have to do is look under dairies in good old yellow pages.
Welcome back. Many a successful director has cut his teeth on horror movies. Take Francis Coppola's Dementia 13, or even James Cameron's Piranha 2. And although it may be one of the easiest genres to access, its protégés are generally much less likely to be taken seriously. A case in point is Italian director Mariano Baino, whose first feature, Dark Waters, almost cost him his life. Shot on location in Russia during the 1993 revolution, Baino encountered problem after problem. But he still managed to complete this dark and gloomy tale and find a UK distributor. Unable to secure a place on the cinema circuit, Baino grudgingly agreed to a straight-to-video release. Inspired by memories of his own childhood nightmares, Dark Waters follows the fortunes of Elizabeth, a young woman in search of her past, which she finds on a remote Crimean island within a sinister religious sect.
I need to reach the convent tonight.
Are you afraid of death, lady? I am. My answer is no. Come back next week.
Man, it's not a particularly great time to be releasing a horror film. I mean, you must be very disappointed that you didn't get a cinema release for the movie.
Yes, I'm disappointed, but, you know, in the end, it's not just my film. I mean, it happens to 90% of independent films now. Even not horror films, they get a straight-to-video release. So in the end, I'm just like, you know, I'm just accepting it and thinking, well, probably next time.
Your father understood that, and I trust we will too in time. In the meantime,
I will do all I can to help you. Our library, our ceremonies, you'll have access to it all. And Sarah is a good girl. She'll make a villain assistant.
Your movie is a sort of blend of Roman Catholic imagery and horror. What exactly were you intending it to be, and where did these images come from?
Well, my intention was, you know, to try and make a horror film, because, you know, too many times in the last, like, 12, 13 years, horror films have been everything but horror films. You know, they've been comedies with a bit of blood, or lots of blood with a bit of comedy, or whatever. But, you know, the idea that horror films should be disturbing, that horror films should sort of linger in the mind, like, 2 or 3 days after you've seen them. That, you know, in the end, if you make a comedy, you want people to laugh. So if you make a horror film, you want people not to come out to the cinema all happy, cheerful, thinking about, you know, their pizzas.
Surely by adding elements like humour, people have only been trying to kind of popularise the genre, and that's surely not a bad thing.
I think they've done it in an attempt to soften it, not to popularise it in the sense to bring the, you know, widen the market to like the 12 years old. But I mean, you're defeating the object that way, you know.
What would you call The Exorcist, for example?
The Exorcist was a horror film. Mm. See, that was a horror film that was not intended for 12 years old. It was intended for adults. And I mean, years ago, like 12 years ago, 15 years ago, the people who went to see horror films were my parents, you know, and their friends. They were already, like, you know, in their 30s, their 40s and whatever. And then there's been a shift lately. It's been like a vicious circle. There's been a shift in horror films where to widen the appeal, they made them softer and more comedic and more sort of like, you know, so that everyone could watch them. And, you know, by consequence, you know, people of a certain age have stopped watching horror films. So, you know, I mean, now it's you're in the middle of that strange thing where horror films are watched by teenagers. People that are not teenagers anymore don't even give a chance to a horror film because they think, you know, it's not for me. And, you know, it's just like it is a bit of a sorry state.
So you think that horror's sort of fallen off the rails, but slowly, bit by bit, is getting back on track now?
In a way, you see, it is happening. The disturbing thing is that because it's happening with big budget things, then they must make a huge effort not to call them horror films. So, you know, you get Dracula, and it's the biggest love story ever told, and you think, Dracula, sorry, you know, it wasn't about vampires once. Mm. And, you know, you get Wolf, and, no, it's not a werewolf movie. I'm sorry, does it change into a hairy beast? Yes. So, you know, it's a werewolf movie. But, you know, in the end, horror films are there already. But, I mean, there's been this thing, because everyone is scared of saying it's a horror film, because horror films at the moment are associated with what we were talking about, you know, Freddy and whatever, they can't do it. You know, I mean, if Silence of the Lambs was a horror film, and it won the Oscar, and when you tell people, they say, but it wasn't a horror film, excuse me, you know, about the serial killer who was a cannibal, you know, it wasn't a horror film, it was.
Are you committed to making horror films? Are you committed to making films?
I mean,
films?
I'm committed to make sort of like films, you know, if you wanted to call them, you know, films of the imagination. Like, you know, I'm not really interested in making real life stories with real life situations where, you know, I could make a film about the relationship. Mm. I mean, I would still try and find a way of making it in a way that is a fantasy film or a horror film or whatever.
From Dark Waters to the Dark Knight now, and for those of you eagerly awaiting the release of Batman Forever, perhaps I could interest you in the full-length animated adventure Batman Mask of the Phantasm, based on the hugely popular TV cartoon adventures. Batman's latest adversary is the Phantasm, an evil vigilante dead set on ridding Gotham City of its mob bosses. With the underworld crumbling about his ears, Bats gets the blame and has to try and bring the Phantasm to justice.
Time to pay for your sins, Mr. Bronski.
Also, just to make his life more difficult, old flame Andrea returns to Gotham City. Batman is torn between his love for her and the promise he made to his dead parents to fight the never-ending war against crime. And who should turn up to help Gotham's dwindling mob population but arch-enemy, the Joker?
Hello, anybody home?
Listen, Boopsy, even though you never call and never write, I still got a soft spot for you.
So I'm sending you a fun gift, airmail. And there's no use jumping out the window this time, toots. The plane of the future is going to make you history.
With its dark setting and bold animation, Mask of the Phantasm makes a refreshing change from the exploitative tales from manga, which are fast becoming our staple animation diet these days. Live-action manga, on the other hand, is a completely different story. Based on the popular Japanese strip cartoon comes Guyver, Dark Hero, the continuing adventures of Sean Barker, a normal bloke who has within him an alien life form, the Guyver. In times of trouble, the Guyver within pops out to take control of his body and fight for the forces of good. The Guyver unit comes packed in a handy Samsonite briefcase, which the evil Kronos Corporation are after. But are their rubbery green monsters any match for our biologically boosted beefcake? So rubber monster fights rubber monster in this very silly film. And in the time-honored B-movie tradition, it's so bad, it's hilarious. Definitely one to watch after a very heavy session at the pub. As the end of the millennium approaches, sci-fi fans are waiting with bated breath for the three Star Wars prequels, which George Lucas promises to deliver, around the year 2000. So, if you don't think you can hold your breath for that long, and I strongly suggest that you don't try, then strap yourself into an X-Wing and prepare yourself for a journey to a faraway galaxy as this week's viewers panel relive that Star Wars experience.
My name's Adam.
My name's Neil.
And we're here to review the classic Star Wars trilogy.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away,
there was a young farm boy named Luke Skywalker.
I want to be a Jedi like my father!
Who discovers two androids, R2-D2 and C-3PO, and together they become embroiled with Obi-Wan Kenobi, an old Jedi master.
Stretch out with your feelings!
Together, they hook up with a star pilot, Han Solo.
I'm Captain of the Millennium Falcon.
And his sidekick, Chewbacca. They fly off to the Death Star to rescue Princess Leia.
Aren't you a little short for a stormtrooper?
From the clutches of the evil Darth Vader.
No!
Finally, Luke finds himself piloting an X-Wing fighter in one of cinema's all-time classic space dogfights. Switch your spores to attack position.
Watch yourself, increase speed full throttle.
What about that tower?
You worry about those fighters, I'll worry about the tower.
Despite the destruction of the Death Star, we catch up with them again in The Empire Strikes Back, where the Empire are still pursuing the rebels across the galaxy, and finally catch up with them on the ice planet of Hoth, where battle ensues.
Brr, it's Parky.
Detach cable! Cable detach!
Luke and Darth clash lightsabers for the first time, and then we get the startling revelation that in fact Darth Vader is Luke's dad.
Your destiny lies with me, Skywalker. Obi-Wan knew this to be true.
No.
Our heroes set off to rescue Han Solo, who's been captured and frozen in carbonite, and now lies in the clutches of the evil bounty hunter Jabba the Hutt.
Your wonky Chewbacca.
This is where we join them at the beginning of Return of the Jedi.
Oh, oh, oh.
Come on! Let's go, and don't forget the droids.
Having rescued Han from the evil clutches of Jabba the Hutt, we suddenly discover that the Empire has built an all-new Death Star, which must be destroyed.
This is the forest moon of Endor. Honest. This is where the rebels attempt to lower the shield, which is guarding the new Death Star. But, oh no, they're captured by stormtroopers and their evil ways. But, as luck would have it, they're rescued by small furry animals. Oh no! Giant mechanical chicken!
These films are absolutely fabulous. They can be enjoyed from 7 through to 70 and way beyond.
Star Wars is the only film I can watch for the several hundredth time and still enjoy.
Absolutely.
If you haven't collected the Star Wars figures, you haven't lived.
These films are brilliant. Star Wars, 11 out of 10. Empire Strikes Back, 10 out of 10. Return of the Jedi, brought down a little by those little furry animals, 9 out of 10.
How can you give something a mark out of 10 if it's changed your life?
And in our second competition tonight, we've got sets of the Star Wars trilogy to give away, with T-shirts, Star Wars bendy toys, and a fabulous Sega system with Star Wars and Empire Strikes Back games for the winner. If you can tell me, what is the name of George Lucas's special effects company? Is it A, Industrial Light and Magic, B, Digital Domain, or C, Image Animation? Phone in on 0891 665566, and may the Force be with you. The period between Star Wars and The Empire Strikes Back was a crucial time for Harrison Ford. His career could have gone the way of Luke Skywalker, God forbid, or shot to stardom, which thankfully for Hollywood he did. 1979's The Frisco Kid was to pave the way for Indiana Jones and subsequent fame and fortune. Set in the Wild West, Ford plays a young bank robber who meets up with a rabbi, Gene Wilder, who's got lost on his way to San Francisco. Hardly surprising, since his knowledge of American geography consists of thinking San Francisco is near New York. Since Ford isn't the hardened robber he's cracked up to be, he decides to guide him to the West Coast.
I'm pretty hungry.
This is certainly not a side-splitting comedy, but there are laughs to be had, mainly from Wilder's charming performance as the rabbi, and Ford provides a great foil as well as a fair portion of the action. For Ford enthusiasts, this film certainly won't disappoint, though I'd not go out of my way to see it again. In part three, the wonderful world of Powell and Pressburger, from A Matter of Life and Death to The Red Shoes. A smorgasbord of international cinema from India to Spain, and classic Peter Greenaway in The Draftsman's Contract. Join me then.
PG tips at last.
Shirley, have you seen my thingamajig?
The drawer on the right.
Who put it there then?
Mum, can I? No, Kevin, not until you've done your homework. Oh. Samantha, phone!
It's all right, Mum, it's...
Steve. Oh, at last, PG tips. That was a taste worth waiting for. Mm. You lot?
What?
Nothing.
Oh.
It's not easy, is it? Trying to get a bit of privacy.
Look, don't give me a hard time. You had the tickets.
Even when you make a private call at home, you end up with an audience.
I'll call you later.
Hopeless. So, you want a private talk? Take a walk. Your own private public phone. No one here with you and everything you say.
Hi. Yeah, me too. Look, I didn't really mean what I said. Well, not all of it.
Ain't a bad start.
What about Friday?
Go on, son.
You won't. You look great.
Boy, come on. Behave yourself. A public phone is a private phone, right? It's good to talk, eh?
After eating, dentists agree plaque acid increases the risk of tooth decay. But chewing Orbit or Wrigley's Extra stimulates saliva, which fights the plaque acid that causes cavities.
When I was a lad, I promised myself four things I'd do when I grew up.
One, I'd tidy my room when I wanted.
Two, I'd make a noise when I liked. Three, I'd only ever eat the things I really like the taste of, like these delicious, crunchy Kellogg's Frosties. And four, I'd have nothing whatsoever to do with girls.
Oh, is that so?
Well, three out of four's not bad.
Adults never grow out of the great taste of Kellogg's Frosties.
You might be surprised The Times has a male fashion editor who not only knows couture, but also what we like to wear.
The Times, at 20p, a small price for a great newspaper.
If you want to be heard, register to vote. Your council will send you a form.
Sally and I not only train together, we tend to eat on the run too. For a simple, healthy lunch, we like to use Quorn in a stir fry. Quorn's vegetable in origin, very low in fat, and a good source of protein. It tastes great. And there's nothing artificial about it. Perhaps I need a bit more training with my chopsticks.
Quorn, a happy partnership of taste and health.
In the PG Tips Aladdin treasure hunt, there are a million prizes to be won.
Oh, don't suppose they've got a magic carpet.
Welcome back. If there's one film partnership to beat them all, it has to be the Michael Powell-Emmerich Pressburger collaboration. Between 1939 and 1956, from The Spy in Black to The Battle of the River Plate, Powell and Pressburger put their inimitable stamp on a series of films that were to influence a generation of filmmakers. Pressburger died in 1988, Powell in 1990, leaving a legacy of magical movies but a gaping hole in the film industry. With a major retrospective about to be mounted at the Barbican in London, we track down Powell and Pressburger's Oscar-winning director of photography, Jack Cardiff, who worked on seminal films like A Matter of Life and Death, Black Narcissus and The Red Shoes, and who was only too happy to take us back to the halcyon days of British cinema.
I was doing second unit for Colonel Blimp, and I had a difficult shot to do, because, you know, with second unit inserts and things, you do all the things that are sort of nothing, like a visiting card or a cigarette going into an ashtray. It's a very dull existence. But on this occasion, I had a whole wall with the heads of animals, horns and things, you know. And it was difficult because it made multiple shadows all over the wall. And, but I had time to do it, you know, on second unit, you can take a lot of time. So I'd done a pretty good job on these horns, and I suddenly heard a voice behind me saying, interesting, very interesting. So this, I looked around, it was Michael Powell, the great Michael Powell, you know. Because in those days he had tremendous authority, and he was looking at it like this, you know, and he said, would you like to photograph my next film?
Telegram to my mother, Mrs. Michael Carter, 88 Hampstead Lane, London, Northwest.
88 Hampstead Lane, London.
Tell her that I love her. You'll have to write this for me, but what I want her to know is that I love her very much. That I've never shown it to her, not really, but that I've loved her always, right up to the end.
So far as a cameraman was concerned, Michael Powell was a cameraman's dream, because you could say to him, I'd like to do this, I suggest that we do this, you know, reverse and do something upside down or something quite crazy. And he'd say, I like it, do it, you know. He'd never say, And I've had worked with a lot of directors who have said, well, let's play it a bit safer. Let's put a, you know, let's make a compromise, you know. But he would say, go ahead and do it.
Hello, June. Don't be afraid. It's quite simple. We've had it, and I'd rather jump than fry. After the first 1,000 feet, what's the difference? I shan't know anything anyway.
Wherever I go to museums all the time, and I study painting. And it's, I always advise people, I've given any lectures sometimes about photography, to go and see the paintings, because that's lighting, you know, you see Vermeer or Peter de Hoogh or someone like that. And you can pick up so much about reflections and subtleties in the lighting. So that when I did Black Narcissus, I rather tended, although it was absolutely different from the nature of Vermeer, I visualized Vermeer in my lighting on that film because it was a sort of a simplicity. We had constant wind going through the set, you know, the breeze blowing, because they're high in the Himalayas, and we had these wind machines, you know, blowing all the way through, so that there was movement and flowing of air and flow, which is always very beautiful, isn't it? And then we had the nuns in this sort of just off-white outfit. So you had this as a kind of key to the lighting, and it really worked very well.
Aya, wake up! Oh, what is it? What is it? It's Sister Ruth! Stop her! She's gone mad! Oh, it's my body!
Ruth, it's not in
the
shh! At the end of Black Narcissus, the last couple of days, Michael said to me, Jack, what do you think about ballet? And I said, not much, Michael. And I said, all these sissies prancing about, you know, and it was a stupid thing to say if ever there was one. But that's what I said at that time. And Michael looked at me in some amusement, and he said, have you ever been to a ballet? And I sort of grinned a touche and said, no, I haven't, as a matter of fact. He said, well, we've got work to do, because the next film is about ballet. It's called The Red Shoes. And I want you to go and see ballet all the time, have tickets every night to Covent Garden. And of course, I was in love with ballet for the rest of my life. So that was also fascinating, because I think Michael said at the time, when we started shooting on the picture, he said, this is going to be something really extra special. We all have to work extremely hard to attain it. And we did. We were all captivated by the possibilities of Red Shoes. There are so many directors leaving legacies. Hitchcock left a legacy, didn't he? Of drama. And one obviously, a lot of directors have taken him very seriously. And Powell and Pressburger left a certain legacy of excitement. People who see those films must get the excitement that they put into them. I think so.
Critically out of favour after the Baby of Macon fiasco, Peter Greenaway has gone rather quiet of late. But tripping stealthily out onto video comes his 1982 feature, The Draftsman's Contract. Anthony Higgins is the draftsman of the title, a lucky man who's been commissioned to make drawings of a country house in exchange for sexual favours from the mistress. It's not long before the daughter of the house also comes calling. It seems she too has need of the draftsman's services. In fact, everyone in this elegant little drama has their own agenda, largely sexual, I have to say. But when the estate owner is found dead in the fountain, the ugly finger of suspicion points to our arrogant artist.
You should not continue to draw, Mr. Neville. I no longer feel able to continue the terms of our contract. The fee is yours, as is the hospitality.
I was about to say that despite all my satisfaction at the prospect of continuing the commission under such delightful circumstances, the peak of my delight, madam, is obtained in those short minutes when we are together. I would regret losing them. Besides, I do not need to remind you that the contract was made between two people. It will take the consent of both signatories to make it void.
As with all Greenaway's work, The Draftsman's Contract looks fabulous. The attention to detail is impeccable, and it's wonderfully complemented by Michael Nyman's superb soundtrack. An intriguing comedy of manners with a decidedly vicious streak, it's probably one of Greenaway's most accessible pieces. To have beaten the wonderful Farewell My Concubine to Best Foreign Film Oscar this year is no mean feat, but that's exactly what happened with Spanish film Belle Epoque, a charming language story. The movie traces the adventures of young Fernando, an army deserter. It's the summer of 1931 and a civil war's brewing. Not that that bothers our young hero unduly, since he's taken refuge with an eccentric artist, who's just been joined by his quartet of beautiful daughters.
Ve y diviértete, hombre, tú que puedes.
Bueno, no sé, pero lo que yo no hago es disfrazarme de nada.
Yo creo que este te sentaría de bien.
Sensing an unmissable opportunity, Fernando decides to prolong his stay indefinitely, and over the course of that summer, his eyes are opened to the pleasures of love in a manner he'll never encounter again. Hence the movie's title, Belle Epoque, A Beautiful Era.
Pero qué desastre eres,
Despite its charming story and rather lovely realization, I must admit I was disappointed by the movie's content, or rather lack of it. Fernando proves to be a rather unappealing and uncharismatic young man, while the sisters have a lot more to offer than we ever get the chance to witness on screen. To be a voyeur while this young man goes about his coming-of-age adventures was not enough to engage me, and how it managed to beat the excellent competition is beyond me. Those judges need their heads examined, but we knew that already. Another film that lost out to Belle Epoque at this year's Oscars was The Scent of Green Papaya, a stunningly beautiful evocation of everyday life set in 50s Saigon. With the war element reduced to the odd plane noise overhead, the film is able to concentrate on the gentler side of life, and in particular, the growing pains of young Mui, a country girl who finds employ in a house in town, where she's terrorized by the younger son. Having lost a daughter in childhood, her mistress looks upon Mew as the daughter she should have had. Her husband, meanwhile, suffers from a peculiar form of seven-year itch, which finds him disappearing for long periods with the mother's hard-earned cash. However, when Mew blossoms into a beautiful young woman and the son of the house gets married, his new wife can't stand the competition and Mew is forced to take work elsewhere. Happily, this turns out to be the best move she's ever made, since it reunites her with her childhood sweetheart. An absolutely stunning film. Hypnotic music, dazzling culinary displays, and underplayed emotion make The Scent of Green Papaya a sensory delight. Director Tra An Hung's sensitive examination of the female role in Vietnamese society is very powerful, drawing unnerving parallels between the bonds of love and the bonds of servitude. Maybe a little languorous for some, but they don't come much more beautiful. Back in 1961, a fledgling American director teamed up with an Indian entrepreneur, ostensibly to make English language movies in India for international consumption. And so Merchant Ivory was born. 33 years and 25 films later, they've become one of the most prestigious independent film production companies in the world. So now would seem as good a time as any for producer Ishmael Merchant to realize a long-cherished ambition with his directorial debut in Custody. Devon is a college teacher commissioned to interview the famous Urdu poet Noor Jashi Kapoor for a local magazine. When he finally meets his hero, he's horrified to discover that he's old and dissolute, surrounded by hangers-on and constantly fighting with his two wives. Determined to preserve what's left of this poetic genius, he procures a tape recorder and attempts to record his ramblings with a few minor distractions en route.
Devon Sahib, मेरे चाहने वालों के लिए भी बिरयानी और रम का इंतजाम.
Everything that could go wrong does go wrong, but Devon is undefeated, realizing that it's up to him and him alone to commit a little of this ailing culture to posterity. Based on Anita Desai's novel, the film is a tribute to the dying Urdu language and a timely reminder of cultural vicissitudes the world over. That said, it is a little self-indulgent in places, and the narrative a trifle stilted. Fine sentiments indeed, but I was rather glad when I was released from custody.
Paddington, Paddington, where are you?
And now, a sad moment for children everywhere, and a time of universal rejoicing for parents. Yes, the new school year is upon us once more, and someone who perhaps hates school more than most is Darkest Peru's biggest export.
Paddington, I've got something to tell you. You have to go to school.
Next week on The Little Picture Show, the real Jerry Conlon sets the record straight in The Name of the Father. Deborah Winger is seduced by literature in Sir Richard Attenborough's Shadowlands. And the return of Johnny Depp in What's Eating Gilbert Grape. See you then. Good night.